Bakr. When I gave the deen and I told him this is Islam, he said, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. And he did not ask any questions. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, you can imagine how many ayat he had memorized at that time. Only a few that had been revealed. And the few dua and the few salah that they had, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu went from that moment to become one of the greatest da'is of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he went to Uthman, and he went to Talha, and he went to Zubayr, and he went to Abdurrahman ibn Auf, and he went to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and he called them to the deen, and he brought them to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his hands, and one after the other, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله, أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu brought these people into the deen. 6 of the 10 people that were promised Jannah, and Abu Bakr is one of them, the 7th, that 6th of them, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the one who converted them to the deen, is the one who brought them to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And on the day of judgment, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu will have in his deeds that he had done that these people, these great people, had entered Islam through his da'wah. And Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمَرِ النِّعَمِ. He said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides one person on your hand, that it is better than the dunya and everything that is in it. And he said, it's better than a red she-camel, because that was the most precious thing that they had. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had brought, through his hands, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had guided 6 of the 10 people who were promised Jannah. In those early days of Islam, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would go around and he would see the Muslims that were being tortured, the slaves and the weak people, and how they were being tortured. And his heart would cry out for them. And he would see Bilal radiallahu anhu as Uqba, as Umayyah, would be punishing Bilal and would take him out in the noon sun. And because he was a black slave from Africa, from Abyssinia, they used to punish these slaves. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would watch as they punished them. And Umayyah would take Bilal out in the noon heat, when the heat was the strongest. And he would press Bilal on the sand. And then they would bring a boulder so that he would press him further down and increase the torture of Bilal. And Bilal would never turn back on his words. And he said that I tried all the different words that would make them the most angry. And I found that when I said Ahad, that Allah is only one, that one, that it would make them the most angry and they would punish me the most. That's the only thing I used to say. And he would repeat in their face, Ahadun Ahad. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would pass by Bilal radiallahu anhu, and he would listen to him saying, Ahadun Ahad. And he would say, Yunjik al-Wahidun Ahad. That one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save you. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he went to Umayyah. And he said, oh Umayyah, sell me Bilal. And Umayyah was very happy that there was someone who wanted to buy Bilal. And he was very hurriedly wanted to complete the sale. And he said, I'll sell you for 5 uqiyah, which is a very large amount of gold. And Abu Bakr agreed. And then he snarled and he snickered and he said, if you, after the deal was completed, he told Abu Bakr that if you refuse to pay nothing more than 1 uqiyah, I would have sold Bilal to you. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he has different skills than other people. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, if you refuse to sell me Bilal for nothing less than 100 uqiyah, I would have bought Bilal from you. That I still would have bought Bilal from you. And then the evil people, and the people that like to spread rumors, and whenever they see people doing good, they always want to cause a problem. The people, they saw Abu Bakr do this, and they started spreading rumors saying that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had done this. That Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had done this because he had a favor to pay back to Bilal, and then he hadn't done it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran and saying that those people are liars who said that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had done this for any other reason than for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Surah Al-Layl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals, وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that he who spends his wealth for increase in self-purification and have in his mind, and he's speaking about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and have in his mind no favor from anyone for which a reward is expected in return. That Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu expects no favor from anyone and expects no return for this, إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى, except only the desire to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the countenance of the Lord the Most High. إلا ابتغاء وجه ربه الأعلى. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of who is going to pay Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu back for this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. And he surely will be pleased when he enters Jannah. And imagine this last verse, وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى, that he's going to be pleased. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Abu Bakr that on the day of judgment that you're going to be satisfied and I'm going to make you pleased on the day of judgment when you enter Jannah. You take this verse and imagine if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that to you, وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى, and try to weigh that with every single thing in the dunya and see which one is heavier to you. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to you that you're going to be satisfied and you're going to be pleased with what He's prepared for you, then indeed you will be pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. When Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu became Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had made him the Amir of one of the armies. And so because he was the Amir, Amr ibn al-As thought that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved him the most. And so he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the battle and he said, Ya Rasulullah, who do you love the most? And he wanted everybody to know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved Amr ibn al-As the most. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I love Aisha the most. His wife Aisha radiallahu anha. And then Amr ibn al-As said, no, from the men, who do you love the most? And he said, her father, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وبعد. Very often people are very concerned about the upbringing of their children. And I've seen with some children, and in fact many, many children, a certain event that happens when they get a ball in their hand. Put a ball in a child's hand and bring a basketball net towards them. And then tell them to take a shot, and even bring it a little closer so they may actually be able to dunk the ball. Listen to what the child says. And I think everybody knows what's going to come out of his mouth. He's going to say, Jordan. He's going to say, Michael Jordan, and he's going to throw the ball. When that boy says Michael Jordan, or he says some other basketball player's name, it's coming from his heart. It's coming from a television that he may be watching 4 hours or 5 hours a day, a television that his father and mother brought in for him to the house. That boy is bringing that out from his heart and calling out those people that he puts up on his walls. The posters of people that he doesn't look down upon, he puts it up on his wall so that he looks up to it before he goes to sleep. And when he wakes up in the morning, he's looking up to a kafir on his wall. And in fact, listen carefully, and that boy is telling you that I want to be a kafir basketball player when I grow up. I want to be similar to this kafir person. And in fact, you will see these people are the worst of creation. And you will see, read their biographies of these athletes, and you will see that they are animals living on the earth in their lifestyle. We may be just watching them on the television, but look at their entire lifestyle, the alcohol and the drugs and all that, and you'll see them dying in car accidents because they were drunk, and you'll see them committing zina, and you'll see them doing all these things. And these, maybe just because of the ball that you allow the child to take this person as a role model, but there's much, much more behind that. And so, and I've lived through this society, and I know that I have brothers and sisters, or specifically brothers that had grown up with me, and now they're in university, and they can throw a basketball in a net, they can spit it with precision into that net. But you ask them to read Surah Al-Fatiha, and they recite it fumbly like a baby would recite Surah Al-Fatiha. They can't recite it. Why is that? Because when they were young and they used to hold the ball, they used to scream Michael Jordan when they would throw it. And they wouldn't call out in their heart Abu Bakr, and they wouldn't call out in their heart Umar, because they didn't know who these people were. All they knew were these other kuffar. And you will see from the seerah how that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions, how they were role models for the children. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the story of Al-Hijra, who narrated? Aisha radiallahu anha. She was a little girl at that time. She was maybe 8 years old at the time of the Hijrah, and she's narrating the hadith. She says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came at the time of Dhuhr, the Dhuhr time at noon. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to visit them in the morning and in the evening, but at Dhuhr time he never came. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu knew that there was something different this time. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came in and he told Abu Bakr that he had been given permission to go for Hijrah. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, As-suhba ya Rasulullah, as-suhba ya Rasulullah, let us go together for the Hijrah, the migration to Medina, together ya Rasulullah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, As-suhba, together.